Hello, everyone, and welcome to part three of our webinar series titled Supporting Secondary Students with Intensive Needs During the Pandemic. The National Center on Intensive Intervention and the Center on Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports have partnered to present a webinar series focused on providing educators with tools to support secondary students during virtual learning and the return to in-person learning. This series is intended for educators at the state and local level who work with students with intensive behavioral needs in secondary school settings. My name is Caitlin Majika, and I am part of the National Center on Intensive Intervention, and I will be facilitating this webinar for you today. As we mentioned, this is part three of our series. If you're interested in learning more, we have a webinar on Check and Connect, Implementation and Adaptation in a Virtual Environment. The recording of that webinar, as well as the slides, can be found on our website. We also held a second webinar in our series focused on early warning systems. And here the panelists focused on how to use data gathered from an early warning system to plan for the 2021-2022 school year. During this webinar, you can hear from a panel of state and local educators from the state of Ohio who have utilized early warning systems during their school year this year, but also during their planning stages for next year. And today we have webinar three. Today we're focusing on intensive intervention, supporting secondary students with intensive behavior needs. We're going to start with a welcome and introduce our two panelists for the day. I will set the stage for fall of 2021. Our first panelist will share information about screening to help identify those students most at risk. Our second panelist will talk about supporting students within an MTSS framework. And then we will conclude with a live question and answer period during the panel discussion. I will close us up with a wrap up and closing and share some resources. Before we get started, I want to share some housekeeping tips. While we will not be able to address questions during the presentation itself, at the end, we've reserved some time for live Q&A. So if something comes to mind during the presentation, please feel free to put that in the question box. I will be monitoring that and be ready to share with our panelists at the end of this webinar so you can hear your question answered live. In addition, if you would like to access live captioning during this webinar, Eliza is going to put a link in the chat box so you can follow that link to access the live captioning for this webinar. In addition, part of our webinar platform has a handout section, and in there you can find the slides for this session, as well as a PDF of a toolkit that one of our panelists is going to share with you if you would like access to those. In addition, all of these resources, as well as a recording of this webinar, can be found on our NCII website at the conclusion of the webinar. So I'd like to start by introducing our two panelists. We are very excited to have them here with us today. We have Dr. Luann Tanner-Jones and Dr. Don Kincaid. Dr. Tanner-Jones has a PhD in school psychology, and she is a nationally certified school psychologist. With Dr. Wendy Ranke, she helped found the Boone County Schools Mental Health Coalition. Currently, she splits time between the coalition and the National Center on Rural School Mental Health. She's worked in mental health since 1980 and has served in a variety of settings, including private schools, residential facilities, hospitals, private clinics, and numerous public schools. She's been a consultant with school districts and has taught at the university level. She's worked with infants to elders and has worked with individuals with disabilities as well as individuals identified as gifted. She's been a direct care worker, a behavior specialist, a psychological examiner, a school psychologist, and has held several administrative positions. She retired from Columbia, Missouri Public Schools in 2015 after 29 years of service. In her last years with the district, she was the Director of Special Services and Section 504 Coordinator. So welcome, Dr. Tanner-Jones. We also have Dr. Don Kincaid. Dr. Kincaid is a professor at the University of South Florida and the director or co-director on the Florida Positive Behavior Interventions and Supports Project, the University of South Florida's subcontract with the Center on Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports, an OSEP-funded grant, the Florida Center for Inclusive Communities, and Florida's School Climate Transformation Grant. All of these projects integrate school-based positive behavior interventions and support within a multi-tiered systems framework or support individuals with disabilities across the lifespan. Dr. Kincaid coordinates systems change efforts at a local, state, and national level to support the implementation of evidence-based practices. So welcome to you both. We are very excited to have you here to share information with us today. And I want to start before handing it off to our first panelist, just to set the stage for this webinar and this webinar series in general. We know that this school year has been unlike any others, and we've heard from numbers of teachers, administrators, state-level leaders, that they're really interested in more supports and resources for what they can do to help plan and prepare themselves for the fall of 2021. We know that more are going to be faced with this return for large-scale in-person learning, and there's a need for schools to identify students who have risk factors, especially to identify students who have behavior risk factors are in need of intensive intervention for behavior supports. In addition, schools also asked for resources that once students are identified, what supports can we put into place? What should we consider to help support these students once identified? So our panelists here today are going to share a little bit more information to help you consider the screening part and the supporting students with intensive behavior needs process. So we are going to start with Dr. Tanner Jones, and she's going to share a little bit about screening to identify students at risk.
Okay, thank you, Caitlin. I appreciate that introduction. I'm very happy to showcase this project that I am working on, one project. We used to call it the Boone County Schools Mental Health Coalition. Now we are the Family Access Center of Excellence, or FACE of Boone County, the school-based side. So lots of different titles here, but what you should take from this is that we are a program that works within public schools in Boone County. And so we'll talk about that today. So again, I appreciate the opportunity to showcase our work. I want to give you just a little bit of a background of what we've been doing here in Boone County so that you can see what our work has been and maybe get some ideas of things you could do in your area. So I'm the past director of this school-based side. I am now working more with the National Center on Rural School Mental Health. But this Family Access Center, again, provides some resources to schools that are very innovative. So a little bit of history. A few years ago, there was a real backlog of supports, or individuals requiring supports or wishing to have counseling, psychiatry, that sort of thing. And in our community, the taxpayers decided that this was something they wanted to get rid of. They wanted to break down those wait lists and have the ability to have individuals in our community to have quicker access to services. So in 2012, there was a quarter cent sales tax put on the ballot, and the taxpayers of Boone County passed that. And it was amazing. There was about $6.5 to $7 million a year anticipated for 11 areas of support for Boone County residents, for basic needs, for mental health supports, for individuals 0 to 19 and their families. So we in the schools in Boone County all got together and decided to become a coalition. So we were a coalition that was very strong and very powerful, and we were able to appeal to this a voluntary board that gave out money, allocated the tax funds. And we were able to get services funded for schools so we could work into our schools and provide services to the students and the teachers and the parents in Boone County. So we created, as I said, a coalition. We had a cooperative agreement, so we were a legal entity, and we created that along with Professors Wendy Rinke, Dr. Keith Herman, Dr. Aaron Thompson, and Dr. Kristen Hawley. So we were again, a legal entity where we were able to work within Boone County Schools. If you would like more information about this, I'm very happy to talk about it, because sometimes people want to know how you get something like this started, and I'm happy to help you with that. All right, let's talk about the next slide here. Let's go to the next one. Okay, so this is a graphic of how we are designed. I would draw your attention to the bottom where it says 54 public and private schools in Boone County. We work with all of these schools, whether they are very small schools, large schools, high schools, private schools. We go into those schools as this partner, and we are able to work with teams, with school counselors and superintendents. We work with administrators, and we are able to provide services based on this screening tool that I will show you today. We are a multidisciplinary group. So the employees that we have are school psychologists, school counselors, social workers, and we are working hand in hand with our school partners. In addition, very, very recently, the school district superintendents wanted to have individuals who would deal with crises in schools. So we are also hiring now individuals who will help families to connect to community services and address crises within their family and for their kids. So we're really excited about that new little wrinkle that has happened into our project. Okay, next slide. Okay. This is a graphic of what we do. We have developed and we now implement a countywide screener. We look at assessing protective factors and risk factors for students so that we can predict hopefully some mental health, some social emotional concerns, and we can put resources in place to keep those problems from developing further and address the issues and help kids to have better outcomes. We provide professional development to school personnel. So we work a lot with teachers. We do a lot of consulting. We also do a lot of PD, and I have a little graphic at the end where you can see some of the topics that we have utilized and how we've pivoted a little bit to work on issues within the pandemic. As I said, we work with school-based teams. So I have some information about how we work with problem-solving teams. We work to make sure those kids who are requiring behavioral and social and emotional supports get those just in time. And then we also improve coordination of information and services for students who are exhibiting some risk. And then we developed and we implement something I do, a child-centered family-based wraparound service for families. So that's a quick snapshot of what we do. Next slide. Our early identification system, this is the screener that we use to identify those kids that are having some risk factors, having some concerns that we want to address. And we are especially interested in looking at those secondary kids to make sure that we know that, we can provide those services to them. We work really hard to make sure that their voices are heard. So we screen all students for social emotional risk factors about 2 to 3 times a year, depending upon how often the school district wants to do it. So kids 3rd grade through 12th grade report on their own thoughts and feelings. We ask teachers from pre-K up to grade 12 how their students are comparing to same age peers. So about 25 to 26,000 kids per checklist round have this screener, and the teachers reflect too in the last 30 days of their school. And they answer the questions. Again, I'll show you in a moment. Norms for these school-based checklists are based on each school. So you're comparing one student to the other students in the school. And the schools really enjoy that. They like that so that it's not like a national norm, which is fine, but they have it more personalized to their own school. So we're really excited about that aspect of it. So again, we look for students who are having some concerns that we can address, to keep small problems small, and to, if the student is having very significant concerns, also to tailor interventions to address those issues. Okay, you want to go on the next slide, please? Okay, so we have that early identification, that EIS system we call it, that we look for the kids that are in need of additional supports. We want to make sure that we're focusing our work and our conversation on proactive prevention models, not just looking at data that is existing like a teacher nomination or examination of some school data like ODRs. We want to make sure that we're identifying with a very proactive model in mind. And I would say in the toolkit, there's a link to a really nice article that NCII put out back in October about the use of ODR. So I would orient you to that. That is a really good article about the pros and cons of using ODRs. Okay, you want to go on to the next slide? This is a very small snapshot of what some teachers would fill out in our early identification system. Items are down the left side, about 40 items or so, that look at different factors, different areas of concern students might display, and then the roster for your class is across the top. And if you can read some of those items, they're very simple questions, things that teachers might in a parent-teacher conference or in a conversation with a parent bring forward, like the student's easily distracted or the student is disliked by peers. or the student has poor social skills. These are not items that are going to identify in terms of a disability. Have you, be eligible for special education or 504 or something like that based upon this checklist. These are just items that we can then determine if there are some future sorts of interventions that are needed. And we have a report that we generate, and I'll show you that in a second about how we look at these screening data. Okay, you wanna go on to the next one? Students will do a checklist where they see a sentence across the screen and they are endorsing their this item for themselves. Like, I have a hard time asking for help. Never, sometimes, often, or always. So in the last 30 days, we ask how often they have felt that way. So you can see, again, they're not scary items, and students have this as part of their culture now. They do this again 2 to 3 times a year. It takes maybe about 20 minutes probably for a teacher to do a class, and less than 10 minutes for a student to complete this for himself or herself. Again, we just make this part of the culture of the school. We do ask parents if they want to opt their students out, if they do not want this to occur. So we allow parents to opt out their kids. Okay, and the parents can see the results also of this for the students. These are areas that we kind of little buckets where we put all the data goes into this. And then we are looking at interventions that we want to provide for students in attention and academic competence issues, like the kids are distracted, they're not getting their homework done, peer relationships or social skills. We would teach that in some of our interventions that I'll mention in a moment. We look at all of these different areas of concern for a student, and then we are able to identify evidence-based practices that append to those different areas. Okay, so let's go on to the next one. Okay, so these data are very, very important in our county to be able to have student level data all the way up to data that is available for those county decision makers to use to determine how they want to allocate funds. And this is used by these decision makers. It's very, very vital information that they have. So I'll give you a snapshot here in a second about what some of these reports look like that the decision makers are able to see. You'll see that we don't have a class level on this slide because we do not want teachers to feel evaluated by this tool. We want to make sure that if a teacher is saying that he or she needs help, that we're able to do that, not in an evaluative fashion. Okay, want to go ahead to the next one? As I said prior, we work directly with these data that we are going to be talking about here with our problem solving teams. So our groups go into schools, go into high schools, go into middle schools, go into elementary schools, and we are helping those teams to identify perhaps broad issues that they want to address within their schools, something of the universal level perhaps. Or maybe we want to work with counselors or some small groups in some process where we could help with some risk factors at maybe a small group or small level, or also we determine interventions at that individual level for kids that are having concerns, where we can link them to outside providers, or we can provide some interventions in school directly with them. Okay, next one. So as you are going to look at these reports here in a second, you'll see a color code, and it's a stoplight colors. It's kind of a public health model, and you may be familiar with this sort of thing. Green means, when you see these numbers, green means less than 15% of students, of teachers are endorsing that students have this concern in the school. So probably nothing universal needs to be done. No, you know, universal like second step or something like that. You might want to look at those individual students that are having those factors, but they don't have to have like a whole group sort of intervention. Kids that are groups that are labeled in yellow would be experiencing some concerns that we think, you know, you might want to do a small group, or you might want to do some type of a tier two sort of intervention to target those needs and address them. But if you have the issues that are color-coded red, then you've got a concern here where it could be a school-wide or a class-wide concern, and you want to pick your intervention that addresses the needs at the appropriate level. Okay, let's just take a look at the next a variety of reports from our system. Okay, go ahead. So this is just a really quick snapshot of a school where the teachers have said their kids have issues in being easily distracted. They're reporting that 26% of their kids are easily distracted. So it's red, meaning you probably want to do something. Your biggest bang for your buck would be a universal sort of an intervention for the kids in this class, in this school. Same with poor academic performance. We need to figure out something that can address a large number of kids, because this is a color code of red, or over 20% of your kids are having issues. You can see 18% for organizational skills. It's something that you might have some smaller groups, maybe SOAR or HOPS or something like that, where you'd have study skills or executive functioning kind of group. And then some of the other color codes that are green means they don't have to have any larger scale sort of intervention, but there are individual kids within that those areas that need some assistance. Poor social skills might be one to look at. That level, or that one, that's a 16% trouble expressing feelings appropriately. You've got some kids that could benefit from some interventions. So again, these are the school's data. We turn this back to the schools. We sit with them and help them to figure out what sort of interventions they want to put in place. Next slide, please. You have this same sort of thing. You have this school. It doesn't have a lot of self-regulation or externalizing large issues. However, they do have kids within these that will need some intervention. So this is what a report looks like. A kid snapshot of a kid report would be that this student in third grade is not having many difficulties with peer relations or social skills. Actually, that's a strength. But this student is bullied. So we want to make sure that we have some intervention for that student. If nothing else, a conversation for that student to help them understand, help us understand what their communication is through this checklist report that they've done. Okay, you can go on to the next one. This is just, you can't see all the items, but this is a color code of a color of a student report that we would make sure we pull this student aside and we have a conversation with that student about what's going on in life and how we might be able to intervene. So we use this again at building level, at grade level, and that individual student level with that problem solving team. We're going to put interventions in place at the right time, at the right intensity. Okay, next one. We, again, match our interventions to the concern, to the level of need, the function. We write SMART goals, action plans, and we measure fidelity. This is where schools many times fall down. The measurement sometimes falls aside. We don't do that very well. So we are very concerned about that, and we make sure that we do that. We also use interventions that, again, are manualized, that are easy to do. Many times teachers are providing these interventions, or we ourselves do that too. So this is the way we are providing interventions that are evidence-based and just in time. Next. A note about students with high needs. This is not part of our process, but we do endorse the use of the Columbia Lighthouse tools for suicide risk assessment and the CSTAG, or the Comprehensive School Threat Assessment Guidelines, prior known as Virginia School Threat Assessment Guidelines, if we have a student that has spoken to us about issues like self-harm, suicide, and also making threats. So those are a couple of resources that I put in the toolkit for you in case you would like to check those out. Next. Again, I said we use measurement. We use data. We make our decisions based on data. And this guides our decisions. At the bottom, I put a little caveat down here. Do not estimate the underestimate the power of data to inform the decision makers as they give you money, as you make money requests, budget requests for more support and personnel to do the work. Data will speak to them. It's very powerful. Okay, next one. Okay, and the last couple of slides, I know I'm running out of time here. I laid the wraparound process. This is called Interagency Committee. This is another process that we use. We work with a lot of secondary students who are having issues with their families having basic needs met, and also the provision of mental health supports and access to community mental health providers. So we work a lot with case management of these students and helping their families link to the appropriate level of support within the community. And then next one. Another thing that we do is, again, we support teachers. We support our staff. Professional development. This is a list of some of the items that we've used. The topics that we provided. And we also are making a lot of these topics COVID relevant, because we know that that is important, of course, right now. We help teachers support AAPI students. That's one thing that we've done just very recently so that we can help to reduce discrimination against the students that we work with that are Asian Pacific Island students. Okay, let's see what else. So again, I went through this group very, very quickly. If you would like to know anything more about our work, please feel free to get in touch with me. The website, Face of Boone County, can give you a lot of information about the entire project that we have. And then if you're interested in some of the information about how this started, that Children's Services Fund website, the Community Services Fund, can give you some information about how this started in our entire county. And that's it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Tanner Jones. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Kincaid now, who will share his section of the webinar.
All right. I'd like to thank Dr. Tanner Jones for that sharing of an exemplary district level system that can meet the needs of all students. That was really very impressive. You may be asking, well, how can we do that in our district? How can we do that in our school? Well, that's a great question to ask her in the chat. But I think what you can see and what I'm going to talk about is how do you take some of those big ideas that form the foundation, some of those major principles that really laid the work foundation for the work she did, and how do you address that within a classroom or with an individual student within that multi-tiered framework? Next. So one of the things we want you to think about is in the current environment that we're in, we've had students that started back to school this year, some that just started back to school a week or two ago. And those that have started back just recently will only have a couple of months. Maybe they'll have some intervention support over the summer, but they really have been in a virtual or hybrid situation. So some of the routines and behaviors may have changed. And as such, we really have to think about looking at that multi-tiered support for all of our students to realize that some students are going to need a little more support adjusting back to the school environment. Things may not have been the same. That certainly wasn't a school environment that they were used to, and they may have had expectations and rules that they followed at school and supports that were provided face-to-face that were not provided as well virtually. So make sure you're addressing your overall school environment. We'll talk about that in just a minute. There may be some students that come back to school that also need some changes in their behavior support plans. The behaviors they came back to school with are different than when they left. Don't make the assumption that what you were doing a year ago is what's going to be working now. There may be needed changes, and we'll talk about how to assess that. But I do want you to think about, before you do start thinking about special education or before you start thinking about intensive support needs of students and delivering intensive levels of support, realize that some students may not need intensive behavioral support right away. They may exhibit some intensive behavioral needs. But it may be that we can do some things at tier one and tier two, or at a universal or targeted level before we start looking at intensive and expensive and time consuming strategies. So we'll talk about all of those in just a few minutes. Next. So some initial steps. The first thing that you should do as students have moved back to face-to-face or will be moving back to face-to-face instruction is to make sure that your tier one systems are in place, your universal supports for behavior. Do you have clear expectations? Do you have effective ways of teaching behavior? What does your recognition and reward system look like for student success? And realize that you're probably changing that some based upon the pandemic. We all know that there are new rules within a school that have to be followed in terms of spacing and cleanliness and wearing of face masks and all of those types of things. So there are new expectations on students. Don't assume that all students will pick those up very easily. Make sure that you have your tier systems in place. You're doing the training, you're doing the support. Spend more time orienting and training that student that may have had intensive behavioral support needs in the past, or you're seeing them with intensive support needs now. Make sure they have more support in the core school-wide system again. I'll talk a little bit more about that. You can also, as I said before, you're also going to need to revise your system to take in effect new expectations and new rules after students have returned to school. It's a different world we have right now, and we have to make those changes within our school. We also have to consider what's happened in the last year to those students. You know, as Dr. Tanner Jones was talking about, adverse issues that may impact students, multiple issues that may impact their mental health and growth, have to realize that one of those is possibly the pandemic, where they've been faced with sickness, death, social isolation, might have presented some issues that weren't there before and may exacerbate some issues the students might have had prior. Think about making sure that you're monitoring those students with intensive needs to make sure that the tier one system works for them. What do I mean by this? Well, sometimes we get referred a student that really needs intensive behavioral support needs. And one of the first questions I'll ask is, so tell me a little bit about when you trained the student on your tier one system, your universal system. What are your school expectations? Well, we trained back in September 1 when school started. We haven't trained since, but the student transferred here in October. Said, okay, check mark. He's never really learned the system, perhaps. And tell me, how many times has he been recognized for doing the right thing, for following the rules and the expectations within school? And how have you gone out of your way to make sure that he's been targeted for that? Well, he's never been good enough to get a reward or recognition. Well, then putting all those things together, he's never actually targeted your tier one system. Make sure your tier one system works. Make sure it works specifically for that student. And if you have to modify or make sure that those aspects apply to that student, do it. So that's the easiest and most effective way to have a first shot at trying to support that student. Make sure that you also consider tier two systems. Have a few of those in place. We've learned that it's not necessarily a good thing to have 12 to 15 different tier two interventions and systems in place in the school and not do any of them very well. It's better to have a couple of those that meet the needs of lots of types of different students and you do them really well. And then finally, if that student does have very intensive behavioral needs and they had intensive interventions in the past, continue those interventions, but monitor to make sure they're still working. And be open to the idea that you may have to change a lot of things. You may have to engage in another functional behavior assessment process or develop a new behavior support plan for that student. Next. Some considerations. This is the only do not. Do not immediately screen or evaluate a student for intensive needs for special education. The screener that Dr. Tanner Jones shared about was, again, to give you information about the strengths and weaknesses of an individual student, not necessarily for referral to special education. So consider the fact that a lot of students might have needs at this point, and it's good to formally or informally screen for that. Do adapt your tier one and your tier two strategies. You're going to do some reteaching. Make sure folks understand your expectations, your rules, your process, your procedures within your school, and they understand that they're going to be recognized for doing good work and behaving appropriately and exhibiting social emotional skills. You do want to look at students that come back to school and they have an existing individualized intervention, intensive interventions for behavior. But you have to be open to considering alterations. They may not match that student anymore, their behavior or other things they've experienced or their growth in the last year. And then finally, consider screening for the impact of trauma and mental health concerns. Remember, as what I said just a minute ago, COVID and the pandemic itself provided an additional trauma and additional issues to nearly every student in some way. So you have to consider that in the needs of all students. Go ahead. So what we're going to do is go back to some basics to think about. Before we start talking about specific interventions for students, let's talk about some basic things we want to do. Our intensive interventions have to be provided in a way that's evidence-based. We want to make sure we do things that we know work, and we have evidence from the literature that show that they're effective. They have to be culturally relevant. In other words, they have to work for different types of students, and we may have to alter them a little bit to work for students from different cultures or students from different environments or in a different community or different family structures. We also need intensive interventions that can go across multiple domains, social, emotional, behavior, and academic. We want to make sure it's very seldom do we see a student with intensive behavioral needs that doesn't also have some academic concerns or social concerns or emotional concerns. So there may be multiple kinds. Interventions have to be effective at addressing multiple things. And finally, we have to do those things with fidelity. We have to do those basic approaches, intervention practices, well. We have to do, if it says that you have to do these three things to make this effective, then we need to do all three of those. We can't pick and choose. We want to do our strategies and our practices with fidelity. Next. So some of the basics, and I'm going to give you some examples in just a little bit, that we want to make sure for all students coming back, and I think this works for students with intensive needs, but also students who might, you're just concerned about, or maybe all students. We want to connect, we want to screen, we want to support, we want to teach, we want to monitor. What that means is that at the contact level, we're going to talk about connecting with the family, connecting with the student, and what has happened to them in the last 6 months, the last year. What are they dealing with? At the secondary level, at this high school level, what are the issues they've been dealing with and how are they doing with that? We have to screen, just exactly what we were talking about earlier from Dr. Tanner Jones, and either formally or informally. And it's a process of may not be high-priced screeners that are used, but you want to identify strength areas of strength and need of students, however you might do that. And then you want to support, you want to create a safe environment in the classroom, remotely, in the entire school. You're going to teach predictable routines. You're going to have very clear expectations for students. You're going to talk about social, emotional, and behavioral skills and how do we teach those. We're also going to talk about how to develop supports that bridge from home, school, and community, so that one thing's not happening in each of those environments that's completely different from another. Give some consistency to that student and make sure that we have very clear feedback and acknowledgement for appropriate behavior for that student. The fourth basic is to teach, to make sure we're teaching academic skills, social, emotional, and behavior skills, and increasing opportunities for students to respond. A very important strategy, very basic thing. Students do better when they are able to respond in an instructional setting versus being given information. And you also want to make sure that prompting of behavioral and social emotional expectations occurs throughout the day. It's not a pullout program for 15 minutes. It's interspersed within all academic, all work within school, all classroom and school environments. And finally, you're going to monitor. You're going to make sure that the safety, the health, the needs of all students. You want to make sure that what you're doing for the student that has the most intensive needs is sufficient, and whether they need to be modified, whether they need to be changed. You want to make sure you're matching the intensity of the monitoring to the intensity of the need. Okay. Next. So this is a graphic that gets a little wild in just a few minutes, a lot of stuff on it. But what I'm going to ask Caitlin to do is to do it in sets of three. I'm going to talk about each one of these five areas and give one or two, three actually, examples of connecting, screening, supporting, teaching, and monitoring. So go ahead and put the first three up there for connect. Great. So the first thing with connecting is make sure that you're scheduling meetings with family and with the student. You know, Dr. Tanner Jones talked about this is a student that we're going to pull aside and have a discussion with. That's what we're talking about. Having that discussion with the student, with the family, what's going on in their life, what's happened, what do we need to know about? We also have to have opportunities for them to practice social skills. You know, those of us that have been working from home, working remotely for over a year now, one of the things they're finding is we've lost social skills because we don't interact with people on a daily basis. Students have done the same. We have to practice those. We have to work with those and build those skills again for that student. And when we're connecting with that student, families, we want to use the family's preferred methods. In other words, we want to make sure that if they want to be communicated with by email, by voicemail, by text, an evening call, a call on a Saturday, whatever works for that family, we have to be able to meet that need. Okay, next, the next three. In the screening area, we really want to obtain information about the family, if about the students' progress. We may know their progress on math or reading, but we may struggle with other things that they've, how they progressed on their behavior support system at home. We need to catch up on that. We also may want to consider a broad array of screening and assessment tools, different ways to get at the idea that we discussed earlier of what are their strengths, what are their needs? How can we build on the strengths? How can we make sure that we have the supports in place to address those needs? And we're going to use all those different data sources to make sure we're selecting the best targeted and intensive behavioral supports. The next three for support. In that classroom environment, a very simple strategy to think about is making sure you're maintaining at least a 5-to-1 ratio of positive to corrective feedback. The student with intensive needs, we can't respond to intensive needs by increasing corrective feedback. That generally doesn't work. We have to make sure we're paying attention to positive reinforcing, positive acknowledgement of that student versus corrective situations. We've got to go out of our way to make sure that we're maintaining that. And we have to do that in an equitable way. One of the major issues we have is we see very clearly through data that many times students of color are not provided the same feedback in the same positive manner. We have to work at a district, school, and classroom level to make sure we address that. It may be necessary for us to actually revise functional behavior assessments and behavior support plans that were developed in the past for that student. Maybe they're not matching that student's current needs. Maybe they need something else. Or some tweaking, or maybe complete overhaul of that process. And then finally, we might want to consider those students who really need person-centered or wraparound. The last thing Dr. Tanner Jones was talking about was that wraparound system. How do we make sure that those students who have multiple complex issues that might involve their behavior, their health, their mental health, their social skills, their academic concerns, their connections to the community, their connections to agencies, their family, all of those issues can be brought together in that person-centered wraparound approach for those most intensive needs students. Teaching then, let's look at that. When we're looking at that and supporting that student with intensive needs, we want to make certain that the behavior support plan has a very active teaching component. Many times we'll see support plans for students with intensive needs, and we can't find a teaching component. What skills are you teaching? Well, no, we've just got something in place here to punish the behavior when it's not occurring, or how do we respond in a crisis? Well, that's not going to be sufficient. If we want to change behavior, we have to teach appropriate behavior, not just punish inappropriate behavior. In fact, punishing inappropriate behavior is not likely to be effective. We want to make sure we have that positive component within the behavior support plan. We also want to make sure that our behavior support plan connects with our tier one framework. So if our tier one expectations in our school are to be respectful, responsible, and safe, then we want to make sure that our behavior support plan reflects those three expectations. So there's a seamless connection between what all other students in the school are addressing, being respectful, responsible, and safe, and what that student with intensive needs is also experiencing. And finally, we want to make sure that that teaching component, the components of the behavior support plan, particularly that teaching piece, is done with fidelity. It doesn't matter how wonderful the support plan is. If it's not done, it's just words on a piece of paper. We've got to make sure we come up with something that works. We support the teachers and school personnel in the implementation of that, and we need to do that with fidelity. And finally, under monitoring, we need to, here they come, make sure we're monitoring the behavior of students with very effective behavior tracking tools. And I know the Intensive Interventions website, as well as other websites, can give you some very easy behavior reporting forms. What you don't want to do is to have 5 students and you have very complex behavior tracking systems for those students and they're all completely different. Make it as easy as possible for the students, for the teachers, for all of the school to engage in that process. You want to make sure that you're monitoring the fidelity of the behavioral system. In other words, what do all students who have intensive needs get, and are we doing it well? And also for the specific behavior support programs of students. So an individual student, If there are 10 components that are done, how well are they done? How often are they done? Are they working? How do we evaluate that? And finally, making sure we have really clear decision rules for non-responsiveness. I've seen students that have been on the behavior support plan for 3 years, the same behavior support plan. They're making no progress, but nothing has changed. We have to make sure that we have very clear as a team approach to identify when do we move on? When do we consider a different set of strategies? Maybe we have the function wrong. Maybe we aren't doing really good interventions that should work. Maybe we're not doing them with fidelity, but we've got to have decision rules to help us through that process in the teaming and problem solving process. Okay, next. So some broad recommendations are to, and these are broad recommendations for the entire system. Make sure that all educators within your school understand your tier three system of behavior supports. They may not have a student that has intensive behavior needs in their classroom, but they need to know what's going to be expected if they do have that student in their classroom. So there's a level of support there. And there are going to have some educators will have students in their classroom. They need to have the beliefs, the knowledge, and the skills to implement those intensive interventions, those tier three level supports within a classroom setting. And that means the next one, that you're going to have a very clear professional development approach at that school level to implement tier three. You've got to make sure that teachers that have students with intensive needs know what they need to do. But what we want to do is to make sure they can do some of those basic things we talked about before, but they also may need to do some specific things related to that individual student. And then the fourth one is we've really got to have district and school infrastructures to make sure you're using evidence-based practices. How do you do that? How do you make sure that what you're doing for individual students should work because we have evidence and research indicating that they are effective practices? And make sure you have good policies and practices between the state, district, and schools. We've done work at an individual school level where we've trained schools in how to provide really good intensive supports to students. And they did a great job, but they struggled because they come back to us and say, but what we're doing doesn't match what our district says is we should be doing. And it certainly doesn't match what our state says we should be doing. So how do we address all of those? And that's probably going to need a bigger level of implementation, a bigger level of systems change than you may be able to address, but you can certainly start at the school and the district level. Okay, next slide. Those are just examples of the different levels. So then at the individual student level, when you've talked about the basic kinds of things you need to do and to support a student with intensive needs, and you've talked about some of the systems pieces we've got to put in place to make sure all students with intensive needs can get the same thing, not just within our school, but across schools. If we've got 5 elementary schools in our district, we should ensure that any student in those 5 schools gets something comparable, high quality, intensive, evidence-based strategies and practices. But we also have to understand that sometimes those students might still need intensive supports even more. And that's where you may have to look at that at students' individual needs and realize we have to understand why the behavior is occurring. That's what we call the functional behavior assessment. That's where we try to understand why is this behavior now occurring? Wasn't here before, or it's gotten worse, why? When we can understand why behavior is occurring, what we found with many, many schools and hundreds of different teachers is that when you begin to understand why the behavior of that student is occurring, it becomes less mystical or confusing or problematic or even difficult. We have a lot of teachers will go through a process of understanding student behavior and they'll go, I get it now. I know exactly what's going on. And what they realize are the things on the right side of the page that they need to engage in prevention strategies. Very simple. If problem behavior is occurring and we can identify when it does and doesn't occur, we can change things in our environment, within our classroom, within our school, within the activities the student does, so the behavior occurs less often or at a less intensive level. At the same time, that's generally not enough, because we can't guarantee that the student will never be engaged in a situation where they are stressed or in too large a crowd or don't know the answers to questions or are embarrassed. We can't always prevent those kind of situations. So the prevention piece gives us time to implement the second part, which is that we need to teach. We need to teach some alternative behaviors to that student that need to be addressed. Those are the social, emotional, and behavioral skills we talked about before. So instead of becoming upset and hitting another student, how do I ask for a break? How do I tell another student no, or to move away from that student, or ask them to leave? All of those things are teaching, our behaviors we're going to teach, as well as prevent problem behaviors from occurring. And then it doesn't do much good to teach and prevent problem behaviors from occurring if we're not going to reinforce, reward, recognize the student when they start doing the right thing. If we're going to teach these skills, when they do it, be excited about it. Make sure they realize what an accomplishment they've had. Make sure that they realize how well they've navigated a very difficult social, emotional, or behavioral issue. And then finally, with every student, you're going to want to make sure that what you're doing matches the context of their life experience. What do they want? Where do they want to go? What are their large and small goals? And how do we get them to, how do we make sure that we're developing interventions that match their lifestyle, match their community, match their family, and even match the context of the classroom? Don't do something to support a student that you know a teacher can't do. It's too difficult. If it takes a PhD in the classroom with a teacher and three graduate students, it's generally not going to be a very effective strategy because it can't be done by that classroom teacher in that classroom environment. So remember those four types of things as general strategies when you begin to understand why behavior is occurring. Okay?
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Kincaid. I will invite Dr. Tanner Jones, there you go, come back on camera for our panel discussion. If you have any questions, please add them to the question chat and I will help facilitate that as well. So there was a question that came in about how we can help increase and promote family engagement and sort of what processes, like how schools can be incentivized during this work to help get those family engagement pieces up and running. Do either of you have any advice or thoughts on, you know, what schools can do to help really promote those family engagement pieces as part of the screening and intervention process?
Well, I would say that's a lot of the work that I do. And as Dr. Kincaid said, which I think is exactly right, is that you want to communicate with the family in the way they wish to be communicated with. Some of these families work nights, and so maybe they want a text message to, you know, to start the communication so that they can get this, you know, when they have a convenient time to communicate. What I like to do is to make sure that our work is person-centered, is family-led. So if we're talking about what social agency supports that families might want, I let the families make the determination of what goals they might want to set. So as I said, we do a top problems assessment. We say, what three things, if they were better for you, would make life easier? Instead of me saying, and you need to work on this, I ask them, and so they feel when I am working with them that their voices are heard. It's not just somebody with, you know, a briefcase and a PhD coming in telling them what is wrong or what they should work on. So that's been really powerful. And then, as I said, as Dr. Kincaid said, to communicate in the fashion, in the manner that they appreciate, instead of it has to be 8 to 5 on my phone. You know, that doesn't work for a lot of families.
I think an additional thing there is to, when you've identified students with specific needs, that's really critical. And I think that schools realize that for the most part, but many times they don't think about involving families at all levels of that multi-tiered system. So when you're developing your school expectations and rules and teaching strategies, are your families involved in that process? Are your students involved in that? We have a large move and a discussion occurring now within the field of PBIS as to, you know, in the past it was the school develops, it has a team and goes and does this. And we began to realize, well, some of those teams were excluding students and the community and families. How do we make sure that they're engaged in that process? Because we believe that they'll buy into that process and support it much more if it's not something that happens to them, but rather with them. And also be receptive to the idea that you're going to be address marginalized populations and diverse perspectives in that process that might not be there if it's just a school-led team.
And just sort of a follow-up question to that, if you run into a situation where parents or families have not been responsive to your outreach, do you have any strategies for what has been done in those situations?
I like home visits. I like to go to their homes. I like to ask if I could, you know, meet them at a coffee shop. And of course, you know, during COVID, that was a problem. But to come to their environment and where they are more comfortable, instead of calling into an office, you know, to come to see me at my spot, I go to them. That has worked very well. And I've had some of my best conversations at the kitchen table with families. So
I think another strategy is that person-centered planning or wraparound process, because you may be able to get better buy-in from that parent and families when they see something that matches what they really need. I remember engaging that process with a parent for the first time for a 14-year-old. And it was interesting because the school started saying all the wonderful things they loved about her son. And she broke down in tears and said, my son's been in your school system for 9 years. This is the first meeting where anybody said anything positive about him. We got to think about what we're doing that might not be not just engaging families, but driving them away from the work that needs to occur and support that needs to occur.
Mm-hmm. Great. So we had another question about data collection. So kind of shifting gears from family involvement. So kind of this notion, data collection needs to be efficient, effective, and meaningful for your purposes. But are there suggestions or strategies you have on how to kind of streamline the data collection process to make it accessible and practical for teachers to implement in their schools? And then for those teams at the administrative level to then aggregate the data and be able to use it and reflect upon it?
So one very quick and effective tool we use is direct behavior rating, DBR. We are able to use the components of that. We will email it to a teacher at the teacher's plan time, where the teacher says, I always see this kid at 9 to 9:45, and I have a little break and up until 10, and I could do my DBR right then. I could rate the students' involvement, respect, and that sort of thing. And so that's been really helpful to us, is when the teacher says, send it to me at that time. So we use either Outlook, or there was an app we used one time called Boomerang, and we put it in the just-in-time location for the teacher, where the teacher says, that's when I want it. And we have to make sure that this is very, very quick for a teacher to report upon, because teachers are very, very busy people. So it takes just seconds to do this, and we've gotten really good results. And then also when the teacher can see a graph, can shoot a graph, you know, through like a Google form, it's very helpful in that way.
Yep. Well, we have reliability and absolute consistency in our response to that. The DBR is the way to go. It's quick, easy. It's the same for each student. It looks the same. So you're not throwing different DBRs around with students or teachers and different ways of collecting data. The other advantage that it has is that, and we use it within our schools, you're able to take all those data and look at school-wide issues. You could look at all 50 students that are receiving support and determine whether they're making progress. And you don't have 18 different data collection systems. You have one that allows you to do that.
Yes.
Great. And we'll just wrap up with one final question due to time. If you are coming across students, you know, given what they've gone through this past year, that have many areas of need. So Dr. Karen Jones, you showed that graphic that had the areas of red were the priority areas. What if a student has many priority areas? How do you choose one to start on or a couple to start on to provide those intervention supports if there are many areas that student needs support in?
I would ask the student. I would see what the student feels like is most stressful. We'll do the top problems assessment with the student. And the kid may say, you know, if you help me in this area, even though I do have concerns in this other area, I think that's my overriding concern. Especially at the secondary level, the kids have some insight. They want to, you know, get the support they need that in an area that's most concerning. Now, if it's a safety issue, then that trumps. You know, we make sure that we can address those issues where the student may be feeling very like they're going to self-harm, that sort of thing. That would be something we would start to approach first. But I want the student voice. I want to know what the student thinks is the most appropriate, and of course ask the parent too. Depending on the functioning level of the student, you'd want the parent to have a voice in that too. But I really shy away from making decisions from people, because this is their life. You know, these are their lives, and we want to make sure that we have their voice in the decision making.
Right. And in-person center planning processes are very similar, very good place to start, because it will allow you to address bigger issues, the needs, get buy-in from that student and that family. But it will also allow you to realize there may be some underlying factors that we could address that addresses eight to 10 different areas that we didn't really, if we tried to look at each thing that is occurring separately, it may not be as effective at realize, oh, if we address this set of social skills, it would support many, many areas that would promote that student's growth.
Great. Thank you so much to our panelists for your insights today and for sharing information about the work that you've done in this area. We are very fortunate to have you. I want to share that our PowerPoint includes some additional resources, as well as a PDF of this toolkit that provides some more information about screening and supports you can implement for students with intensive behavior needs. And I just want to thank you all for being here today, share that the work here has been sponsored by U.S. Department of Education Office of Special Education Program funding. But this is not an official endorsement by the U.S. Department of Education in any way. As a reminder, in the handout section, you can find the slides and the toolkit PDF that we talked about today. Eliza also has shared a link to the National Center on Intensive Intervention website that provides you the information about the entire webinar series we have with more resources. And then in addition, on our website, intensiveintervention.org, we have a number of different products and content.